I'm blinded. I was reminded by some ladies who came from the city worldwide. We welcome you. For those of you in London, it's not as really as we're experiencing it at this point, but we welcome you nonetheless. You've got good. I know that we do not get the opportunity to sing some new songs right here. Well, the songs are not people like this. So I'm sure that some of you here this morning, you might have a special Christmas song that you like, a Christmas hymn that you like. Alright. So, you know, you wanna just say, call out a hymn, then you'll like to hear us sing this song. Quickly. Time's of the essence. Which hymn? Alright, that's one. Which one? You want me to sing? Alright, but you want me to sing or not? Let me find it first, so that I make sure that my own is. Thank you.
Come and worship, come Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest,
And the Lord God will give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be none. Then said Mary unto the angel, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. I want to read a few verses of our scripture. Again, right there in Luke's Gospel, taken from chapter 2, from verse 1. Chapter 2, verse 1 of the book of Luke. And it says, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judah, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And they were in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards all men. If we join both scriptures together, this would be a perfect summary of the Christmas message as we know. Many things are said about Christmas. Some true, some partly true, some downright false. There is, however, one thing that can truthfully say, about Christmas, and that there is an increased focus on Jesus around this time of year. His name is mentioned over and over. At no other time of year you hear the name of Jesus mentioned so much. You hear about the Son of God so much. It's mentioned in a lot of songs, seasonal songs. Among believers at this time of year, there is always discussion about the commercializing of Christmas and about the fact of whether the 25th of December was in fact the actual birthday of Jesus. I am not here to go into those discussions. Non-believers at this time of year, their houses are brighter than everybody else's. As a matter of fact, more often than not, the houses receive the most lights are not even believers. So it is a heightened time where focus is placed on Jesus. And in this season, I would like to address two questions that are asked frequently around this time. First question is, why did Jesus come? Or why did Jesus become man? The second question is, was he really the Son of God? A simple answer to the first question, why Jesus became man, answer to that question can be taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 21, which says, Jesus came, and you shall call his name Jesus. The angel was speaking to Joseph and told him, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. So a simple answer to the question, why did Jesus become man? We can quote that to save his people from their sin. And in relation to the other question, was he really the Son of God? A simple answer to that question can also be yes. He was in fact the Son of God, as stated by Jesus, by God himself. About twice in the book of Matthew, because we remember once when Jesus was being baptized and we are told and the dove came out of heaven and they heard a voice saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Matthew's Gospel chapter 17 verse 5 takes us to the passage that we like to refer to on the Mount of Transfiguration, when they heard a voice, those who were with Jesus heard a voice and said, that said, "This is my beloved Son, hear ye him." And it is believed that those words were said by God the Father. So God the Father proclaimed that Jesus was in fact the Son of God. So a simple answer to the question would be yes. But I believe the significance of both answers is revealed in the actual birth of Jesus Christ. And I would like for us just to focus there for a few minutes. The birth of Jesus Christ. What about the birth of Jesus Christ that helps us to answer the questions? Why did Jesus become man? What about Jesus' birth that gives us answer to the question, was he really the Son of God? The thing about the Christmas story and the thing about the birth of Jesus Christ is that the story has been told and retold so many times over. Those of us who are a little older than others would have heard it a little more. However, our familiarity with the story of Jesus' birth can lure us into the contempt of disregarding one of the most important elements of Jesus' birth. That element is, he was born of a virgin. The virgin birth. The virgin's birth is one of the foundation doctrines, teachings, beliefs of the Christian faith. As Christians, as believers, we believe that if there was no virgin birth, then we cannot claim who Jesus was. I believe the virgin's birth, that focus, answers both questions for us this morning. First, I want to ponder. The virgin birth gave Jesus a sinless character. The virgin birth gave Jesus a sinless character. You see, if Jesus had a human father, then he would have inherited a sinful nature just as the rest of us. We're reminded in Romans chapter 5 verse 12, Paul writing to the Romans, he said, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned." Writing in the same book of Romans, Paul said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So if Jesus was born by natural birth, then he would have a sinful nature. But you see, if he had a sinful nature, then he could not, like Matthew's Gospel chapter 1 verse 21 says, he could not save his people from their sins. Because you see, the lamb, the sacrificial lamb, had to be perfect. That is why we cannot die for each other's sin. Paraventia, when I said that, I had to laugh because we know whenever I know someone who says no one time, he's the only paraventia. But you see, that's why we cannot die for each other's sin, because we have sin of our own. So if we are dying for anybody's sin, it would have to be our own. And the truth is, we are not even worthy to die for our own sin. The lamb, the sacrificial lamb, had to be perfect, sinners. And so Jesus' birth, he had to be born sinless. in order to fulfill his mission of forgiving his people of their sin. Peter, the spokesman for the disciples, he said in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22, referring to Jesus, speaking about Jesus, he said this. He said, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. John, another of the prominent disciples, speaking about Jesus in 1 John chapter 3, verse 5, he says, and ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. If Jesus was the son of Joseph, he would not possess a sinless character. Without the sinlessness of Christ, there would be no salvation of man. Jesus himself said in Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 10, he says, he came to seek and save the lost. Man was lost in sin. Man needed blood to be shed, but not any old blood. Man needed the blood of a sinless lamb, a perfect lamb. If Jesus was a sinner in any sense of the word, he could not provide salvation for us. But because he came into the world by supernatural means and lived a sinless life, he could be that sinless sacrifice for our sins without spot and blemish. The Bible makes it clear in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Christmas reminds us of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. The virgin birth of Jesus Christ reminds us why Jesus became man. Answers the question of why he became man. Why? To save his people from their sin. He could save us because of his virgin birth. In relation to the second question, his virgin birth revealed Jesus as the Son of God. We ask, was he really the Son of God? We don't need to go very far. Examine his birth. The virgin birth of Jesus speaks of a uniqueness. No one else has ever come into the world the same way as Jesus. No one else. No one else is recorded in any history book that an angel came to them while they were betrothed to a woman to be married. An angel came to them and said, oh, she's pregnant through the Holy Spirit. So get married to her. Some of us in that day, if an angel attempt to appear to us to tell us that, we pull off our glass and an angel there. No one else ever came into the world the same way as Jesus. The unique and miraculous nature of Jesus carried on through his entire life. His birth was a miracle. Mary herself asked the question in Luke's Gospel, chapter 1. Mary asked the question, but how this thing is going to be? I'm a virgin. How are you coming to tell me that I'm going to have a child? She couldn't even say that to Joseph. It was the angel who had to go to Joseph and tell him. His birth was a miracle. Immaculate conception, it is called. And those words are only related to Jesus Christ. His public ministry consisted of miracles. Jesus lived a sinless life. He is our example. He miraculously came back from the dead. He left this world in a miraculous way. Church, add that up out of all those things, isn't he really the Son of God? From his entrance into the world until his departure, the life of Jesus Christ was unique. He was different. The most well-known verse of scripture points to that fact. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave who? His only begotten Son." He was in fact the Son of God. He is in fact the Son of God. You remember the story this story is recorded in all three of the synoptic gospels, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Matthew's gospel is recorded in chapter 8, Mark's gospel is recorded in chapter 4, Luke's gospel is recorded in chapter 8, where Jesus was in a boat with his disciples and he was sleeping, and a storm rose. And the writers differ in their description of the event. Some highlighted other aspects. But the basis of the story is that they went to Jesus and they woke him up and they said, "Master, you sleeping in a storm?" And we are told he got up. And scripture reminds us of the famous words that says, "Oh, ye of little faith, what are you so worried about?" And the Bible tells us he rebuked, the King James Version puts it, he rebuked the winds. The more modern version says he spoke to the winds, he spoke to the storm, and there was a great calm. And even the disciples, even the men who were with him, the men who were with him day in day out, who probably should have known him better than anybody else, while they were in the boat with him, and they realized this man spoke and the winds became calm, they asked themselves, "What manner of man is this?" Hallelujah. I think they were saying, "Look, something different about this fellow. No, he ain't just a man alone. Some people like to deem him a prophet, but he's more than a prophet. He speaks to the winds and the waves, and they obey him. He says, 'Peace, be still,' and there is stillness. Something is different about this guy." And so some people like to degrade his authority, and let me normally say, degrade his rank and call him just another prophet. Well, I came by just to let you know this morning, because of the virgin's birth, he ain't just another prophet. He is, in fact, the Son of God. He is the Son, the only begotten Son of God. Christmas ought to remind us that Jesus was born of a virgin. And the virgin birth reminds us that he was sinless. He was sinless. And because he was sinless, he could be the Savior of the world. Because of the virgin's birth, he is in fact the Son of God. There are a lot of theories out there, and a lot of questions, and a lot of things that are being said. Church, he is the Son of God. That's who he is. And Christmas should remind us. One of the things I always see is that if you are celebrating someone, the celebration should reflect some of the characteristics of that person. He is in fact the Son of God. As we go through today and the rest of the holiday season, let us remember who we are celebrating. We are celebrating the Son of God. We are celebrating perfect Savior. We are celebrating the Son of God. It is my prayer this morning that to celebrate, our celebration will reflect the Savior we are celebrating. We have the privilege of hindsight. We have the privilege of knowing that He came to die for us, and the privilege of knowing that He actually died. Let us celebrate in that manner. Let us celebrate in that fashion. Yeah, we might not have the most lights on our arms, but let us celebrate by the life we live. By the life we live, let us say to the world, our Savior, our Savior, the Son of God, that is who we are celebrating. That is who we are celebrating. I want to take this opportunity to wish all people this one a very blessed and holy Christmas season. And I do pray that we all will live our lives reflecting the fact that we are celebrating the Son of God. We have no control over what is done, what somebody else does. We have no control over it. Sometimes we pay so much attention to what others do that we forget to do what we are supposed to. Let's just do what we are supposed to. Let's celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let's pour our hearts in. Father God, we do thank you for this time we can spend in your presence and be reminded of who you are, be reminded of your birth, the significance of your birth, because God, as we think of it, your birth reminds us who you are. It is my prayer this morning, God, that as we go through this holiday season, may our celebrations reflect something of the celebration. May our celebrations reflect the fact that we are celebrating the arrival of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Strengthen us, I pray. Bless everyone, God. Those who came out early this morning, every family represented, I ask that you bless. You touched them, Father God, those who are joined with us via the web, I ask your blessings on their lives. This Christmas season is different for us in a lot of ways, because we have been asked by the health authorities not to gather because of the pandemic. That's all on us. But God, we don't need to gather to celebrate the King of Kings. We don't need to gather to live the way you want us to. We do not need to gather for our lives to reflect the Son of God. So I pray this morning, though we are unable to gather as we are accustomed, that you will strengthen us so that we will still be the people who reflect the Jesus. Who is the Son? Thank you for sharing your word with us. Thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for blessing us and keeping us safe on this time. In Jesus' name, amen. And then before we leave, there is something that we will normally do on a Christmas morning. So I'm going to ask two gentlemen, Fitzroy and Kerry, could you come? We want to take up the offering. I don't want you to have your gifts for Jesus and move out with it. So we want to take up the offering. Can we pray? Father God, you have blessed us. You have blessed us with our finances. And God has recognition of that fact. We come giving back part of it to you. Who blessed us with you in the first place. We ask God that as we give back to you, that you will continue to bless us. And that it will be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 And amen. And amen. And we leave it out.